Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and we are back for episode 164, a number that only means anything to anyone that was the day of birth bonanza first time, but I am back with the person who thought that was how many episodes that we had recorded at that point. So was day of birth bonanza at that time, just for clarity's sake, was episode 73. So we're back, episode 164, and I'm joined by Dynamite Brodie Adler. Welcome back.
Thanks, dude. How are you?
I'm doing very well. It's been a while since we've had this kind of chat. We do little things through the messenger and the Twitter and all that kind of stuff, but it's a lot has changed since we last did the podcast, and I thought, who better to catch up with in this last season before I take a who knows how long hiatus than yourself? Because we've had a great few chats and a right good time as well.
Yeah, it's been a beautiful friendship. It's been beautiful.
It has been. I don't know. I haven't got them behind me. I was like, I thought I had my Winter Soldier and that behind me, but they don't. I have no idea where they are at the moment. They're just this room. It looks all nice at this level, but if I put the camera down at all, it's just all baby shit. Right now, it's just covered, this floor.
Mine's is the opposite, man. I've got bits of my car, like chairs and airbeds, backpacks. Oh, honestly, I'm trying not to look at it. I'm looking in this corner so that it doesn't stress me out too much, because it's just crap. And I've just not tidied anything because I can't be arsed yet.
Well, because you're just back from download, wasn't it? You're just back from there.
Got back last night, yeah.
Tender. Feeling tender?
So I had full intentions of going down and being like, blah! But what did I bring with me? I brought with me like 2 crates of Strombo, a crate of Brewdog, a bottle of Amaretto, a bottle of Jack, a bottle of Jaeger, and a bottle of rum. And I came back with a crate of cider, a bottle of rum, a bottle of Jaeger, a bottle of Amaretto, and a bottle of Jack, and everything else just got spread out to the camp. I barely drank anything all weekend. It was just pure no sleep. I was driving back up like really, it was a dicey drive, man, but I got home alive. that's all that matters.
So by the sounds of it, then you're quite sober. Was just enjoying the music, or is just you know did you realize you're now at an age where you're going, as far as I want to enjoy myself without the fear of a hangover?
Yeah, I feel like it was only my second download, but I feel like my 30s have hit me like an absolute ton of bricks, man. I just can't do it anymore. I've had a few nights out this year so far. Like, I went out for my birthday and I hardly had any drink, and I'm like, oh, it's 1 o'clock, lads. Like, should we maybe go up the road? And everyone's like, what? Like, because I used to be, when I was younger, I was a bit of an animal when I was out, and I think I've That grave's been dug, man. I just don't think I've got it in me anymore. Not at all.
Yeah, my 30s, they gave me the unfortunate thing of a 2-day hangover, but not a 2-day not a proper 2-day hangover. It's, if I get drunk on Saturday, Sunday I'm fine. Monday I'm hungover, which I don't know if it's
weird.
And it's same if I go out on Friday get pissed. Saturday absolutely fine. Start to slow down Saturday evening. And then Sunday, I'm just hanging.
I just get ruined, man. Like, I can have four cans of Brewdog or something, the next day I can be like, oh my God. And then I'll be like that the next day as well. I don't know what's happened to me. I think it's because during the first lockdown, it was every night. We were going hard at it every night, man. Just pure, oh, we'll have rum tonight. Oh, tomorrow it will be Jack. And then we'll need to go to the shops and get more brew dogs and stuff. And I think it's honestly just, it's tanned my arse so much that I can't anymore.
I know.
That's what COVID done for me.
We've got a little table of all of our spirits and stuff, just the fancy bottles, the ones that look nice, like your Crystal's Head and all that kind of stuff. It looks like it's gathering dust at the moment, because of course, someone in this household can't have anything, can't have gin or rum or anything that they enjoy. And I'm like, I kind of want to be available to, if something, well, I was having, at the start of the news of, well, obviously pregnancy and all that kind of stuff, I was like, that's fine, I'll have a wee cheeky vodka here, I'll have a beer tonight, because, you know, you're driving. And then now I'm at the point where we're like 2 months away, and I'm like, right, I've got to kind of be on edge just in case. You never know.
Time's fragile, man. So
I'm like two beers, and that's it. Outside of like, I did the K&K Wrestle Factory one where I had like six beers, got pissed and shot on everyone. So, you know, so there's there's exceptions to the rules when it comes to it. But oh man, that was a. I don't know, I felt fine the next day as well. And then I watched back the first 5 minutes. I buried someone. I was like, oh, what a dick.
You sound like all of us, like on the bus up in the car up to Caithness, man. Like Caithness is literally the only place I can drink and get up the next day, like morning, because I feel like Lucha kind of rubs off on me in Caithness, and he's like, stop being a baby, just moan, like be a man. Okay, sorry. So he kind of whips me into shape, but I don't have him around all the time, so I just revert back.
So it's like Lucha, the dad in the car. He's just like, right, you're fine. Just walk off. You'll be all right. Carry on.
Pretty much, yeah.
So like I said just before we hit record, this will probably be the most wrestling heavy episode that we've done, because the first one we did was just the start of pandemic, way back when. I can't remember, must be the first 10 episodes, was it? Something like that. Because you were really early on in the first ones. Episode 7 was the first one.
Oh my goodness, really?
Episode 7. So I went out in August. So must have recorded it around about July in 2020. So nothing's happened. And at that point, you would have had like 4 matches. So
yeah,
not a lot to speak about, really. And because it was 7 episodes in, I still hadn't thought about doing notes. Because who would do that? Until about episode, I don't know, 20, I think I decided to actually do some notes for episodes. So then we did that. We kind of caught up in the middle when Brodie striked back later on the next year. I think around about, we seem to catch you around about middle of the year each year for our catch-ups. Yeah. It's like, it gives us a little bit of a year, 10 months to a year gap to find stuff to speak about.
I think the last one was before I got back on shows as well. So it still would have been like... Still waiting.
I think so, yeah, because I would have come out August and then you get back in October. So, yeah, we would have had, I don't know how, it was a longer episode. So, I don't know whether I just became that comfortable at that point. I was like, Pokemon, let's discuss.
Yeah.
And then we just spent like an hour speaking about Pokemon. I don't know if you watched the Tom Atlas episode, but I
of course, yeah.
I got a little bit rattled by Rotom again.
Oh, dude, I messaged him right away, just like, here. I feel like I'm not angry at you, like I'm just disappointed in you. So, and we had a bit of a firm chat about it, but I've not brought him round. So
terrible, absolutely terrible Pokemon, the worst. So yeah, let's actually speak about wrestling for a bit then on this Pirate Wrestling podcast. So shows came back. We spoke about that FCW, and then last time we spoke it was just before Renegade. So the first Renegade show, stressful because of everything that went on about it. Was it going to be a Renegade show? Was a show happening? And all that kind of stuff. But you got in the ring, main event, against Regina Rosendahl. What was it like getting in? First new company, familiar grounds, but going in the ring with a pioneer of Finnish women's wrestling.
It felt like there was a lot of pressure on not only just like everyone who's in the Renegade, but like myself, like I felt the pressure getting into the ring with someone like Regina. I didn't really know what to expect, and I knew that she had had like a lot more experience behind me, and she'd kind of ducked in and out of some of the training sessions and kind of worked with us a little bit, but I didn't know what to expect. And if I did know then what to expect, then I probably would have been like Popeye and Spinach for months before it, because I got ragdolled something fierce. It was a really, really good match. And from what I remember, I had a good time and I loved it. And the crowd loved it, but I did get concussed during the match, unfortunately. So I don't have a full memory of it. I don't really remember going out that night or the next day, but I remember it being good. I know that it was a 15-minute time limit match, and my lovely friend Luke Matthews didn't start the timer until 5 minutes in. So instead of 15 minutes, I got leathered for 20 minutes, which was, it's something I'm not, that's one thing I'm not going to forget over Luke Matthews anyway. But it was good. The show was brilliant. The atmosphere was absolutely fantastic. Regina was just, she was really, really great to learn off of as well. She was brilliant. This cat's about to bite me, sorry.
I'm looking up the match because, of course, I reviewed it because that's how I've gotten through things like lockdowns and what have you and pandemics is trying to fit in some wrestling when I'm not chatting to you. But no, I was putting, it was just two brute forces colliding is my exact words. No flips, and I literally put the words no flips in whoopsie doodles. So I don't know what I was on that particular day for writing. But no, just a war of a match. And if you, I wouldn't have guessed that you were impaired in any way in that. So I don't know if it was just a case of you're on autopilot at that point or Regina was just that good that she kind of guided you.
I think it was a big bit of both. Regina was obviously, she took me a lot through the match and she kept me right and she kept me going. But I think just... because we always had it drilled into us, like, just keep going. Like, if anything happens, like, unless it is, like, really, really bad, just keep going. And I did. And I remember looking back on some of the footage and I'm like, oh, that's cool. Did we do that? And then I saw one picture in particular and it was the instant that it happened and I was just drooped down in the corner like that. And I was like, can I hold in my head? And I can see my mate Graham, like, checking on me because he's the ref, and I messaged him just like, you didn't check on me. And he was like, I checked on you several times. And I was like, no you didn't, like, I'm a referee, I checked on you several times. Like, oh yeah, maybe that's I'll take your word for it then. But it was good. Like, it was, I think it was the kind of match that I really needed to push my boundaries out quite a bit, and I took a lot from it, and I took a lot from Regina as well. So it really was invaluable to me, and I'm grateful for Renegade for giving me that opportunity.
So from going there, we'll kind of go through what you've done since we'll chat, and we'll go through the questions as well. But so from there, you obviously got to finally get in the ring with Cassie King as well, which is a long time coming, because I remember we were talking about in the first episode that you were, that it was her that was supposed to make the debut, I think, if I remember rightly, and she had to pull out, and it was yourself that got the opportunity instead.
I snatched it from under her little feet.
So I was like to finally do that. I was for Source. So I was the first Source show back. So again, familiar ground because it's Source Wrestling School, but this was the first Source Wrestling event back since the pandemic. So again, high emotion, just what was it like?
I think it's kind of difficult to say, but I think Cassie agrees with me that we weren't really at our full capacity that night. I think anyone kind of looking back on that match can see that we're both a bit, oh my goodness, like, you'll probably have noticed that me and Cassie have had a few matches in the past 6 months now, mm-hmm. and I feel like we've kind of gotten better with each other and gotten more chemistry over time. And I purely put it down to, like, I'm sorry to break kayfabe here, but Cassie's my best friend and mm-hmm. we've trained together for years and years. She was probably one of the only kind of two people outside of my own partner that I saw the whole way through lockdown, because she made the effort to drive me about and come and get me and stuff. And she became like my best friend. So I think it's difficult when we had that first match back and we've got very different styles and we just clashed a little bit, but we went on to wrestle each other in FCW and we had a great time. And then we went on to wrestle each other again in Source and we had an even better time. So I'm looking forward to the next one because I think it will be great. I just hope it's not in the next 2 months because I'm sick here.
That's the thing. Sometimes it is a little bit oil and water because it's like, even things like Hardy's will be my example for this. It'll probably work out well. You'd think the Hardy Boys, Matt and Jeff, would be amazing matches. They would have incredible matches together. Their styles should kind of fit, but they never really did. And even though I'll still watch them back because I'm a big Hardy Boys fan, that just goes without saying, but they just never clicked well together. I don't know if that was the same kind of thing where they were just two brothers, they knew each other too well, and they kind of, I don't know, second-guessed each other a little bit more than they would a normal opponent, or I don't know. But yeah, it's not unusual, I suppose, if you're so close to someone for the match, it's just not to gel as much as you kind of hope.
I think that probably would have been it, yeah. But I think now that we're kind of getting used to, like, when we're in the ring, we're not friends, we're opponents, and we need to be professional and stuff. We've kind of clicked on to that a bit more, and we've got a bit more used to, like, hurting each other, I guess. But it's good because it kind of means, because we're so comfortable with each other, we can just absolutely go for it, which is great fun, because she's a tiny wee thing and I am not above chucking her the hell about, because it's great fun. It makes me feel big and strong.
It's like when you go to Asda and that, and you get the little cans of Dr. Pepper and that, you just like hold them in your hand going, I'm a giant kind of thing. Yeah, you just go, exactly. Off, throw you. So we won't go through every match. Like I said, you've had a few with Cassie now, back in FCW as well, and returned to Source, the Proving Grounds tournament back in May, which will still be last month when this comes out, of course, because this finishes on the 1st of July. But that's the only place where you've been going. Of course, Combat League Wrestling returned, and it seems to be. I've got a couple of the shows still to watch. Thankfully, the guys sent me a copy of the first two shows anyway. But it seems like a totally different environment in Combat League. How do you find just that in general? So you've got the long travel, and then you've got this kind of, like, I don't know, bubble in Caithness to work in.
I absolutely adore Combat League. Like, I love it so much. From, it's like a 6-hour drive up there, and it's myself, Glendon Barr, Lucha DS, Logan Smith and Taylor Veit, and it's just 6 hours of just total, I don't even know, it's just pure banter, like, the whole way up. I hate to say it's pure banter, but it's such a laugh. And then when we get up there and we meet everybody, it's just such a kind of, it's like a pure cleansing ritual. It's so weird because it's very out the way. We don't need to carry any of our own crap up there. Like, if you've got stuff going down in here, or you've got stuff in wrestling down here that's getting to you, it's fine. You can go up there. Nobody knows you. Nobody knows the shit you're leaving back home, and it's great. But something I love is the trust that the promoter gives you up there to just be, like, creatively free. Like, I've taken Brodie to, like, a completely different place when I'm up there. So the first match I had was me and myself and Lucha DS versus RJ Cash. And
I can find it. That's fine. Was it Albion De Quincey? Because it's a little complicated name.
Oh my goodness, it was. It was Albion. And I should know that because I'm using that against him just now. Yes, it was Albion.
Not that I distrust you, I'm just going to go double, just confirm while you're talking.
You're right, it is absolutely him. My second match was myself and Eric Arkham versus... Oh my gosh, what's wrong with me?
Right, there we go. Right, first one, yep, House Raven versus House Wildcat. You're not going to feel good about this. It was Lucha DS, Brodie Adler defeating House Wildcats, RJ Cash and Logan Smith.
Maybe I got kicked harder in November than I thought.
House Champion, what was that one? That was House Stag, Taylor Veit and Albion De Quincey, defeating House Raven, Brodie Adler and Eric Arkham. So you just mashed two matches together. That's it.
Right. See, when you say defeated, it was a DQ, okay? Like, nobody pinned us, so for starters, I need to put that asterisk up there. So I got my first heel turn, which was lovely, against Albion. And I had a match with him last month. So I've got this wee bit of my head that I shave, and I accidentally got my friend to shave it all off. So I was like, I was like half Uncle Fester and half Brodie. So I thought, right, I was going to do some face paint for this one to try and just experiment a little bit. So I ended up having to just draw all around here because I had nothing there. So it made me look a bit more, I don't want to say evil because it's a bit of a beige word, but it was a bit more like evil, I guess.
A bit like the Luna Vachon kind of thing,
yeah,
going on.
Yeah, there was like some inspiration taken from there and from like Bill Nakano and stuff. And I loved it. It just, I felt like I could channel like a pure demonic part of like Brodie, and it was just so much fun. And it made me feel really happy that I went up there with the promoter not really knowing what I was totally going for with it, without me totally knowing what I was going for it. But it was like, just do it. Just do what you need to do. I just want you to get this across and we can do that. And it's just really cool that we can go up there and have that kind of creative freedom. And it's so much fun. And the crowds are just, they're mad for it. They absolutely love it because, I mean, they're like really out in the sticks, so there's not really much going on. And they get the wrestling shows, and it's just brilliant. They just go mad for it. So it's a lot of fun up there, and I really do love it.
That's it. I mean, outside of big nerds like myself, it is really so far out the way that it is literally its own bubble. Like I was speaking to Lad Chapman, I think Connor Rose as well. They both kind of said the same thing, where it was just like, we're just up in Thurso, we're just doing our own thing, we're happy doing it. We'll bring people up to experience it, but really we're just happy to do our own thing and just in entertain the people that are coming to the shows, because like you're saying, they're in the sticks. So the folk that are coming are really coming to see some wrestling. They're not just going, oh, there's a show on this weekend and I'm as well just go. They're coming to see some wrestling. That's
a really, really cool part of it up there, man. Like, because a lot of the guys, like, they wrestle those shows and that's all they do. They'll wrestle those shows and then they'll train, and then they'll train for the next shows. And I think that's a big part of it for me, because there's like pure no ego when you go up there. And I'm not saying like there's pure hunters of ego down here, but at the end of the day, we're wrestlers. There's a degree of ego involved in what a lot of us do, I guess. But when you go up to Caithness, like, you can just tell that they're doing it because they just love doing it, and they love entertaining. They love entertaining their people, and it's just cracking. It's just such a nice kind of refreshing take on performing on shows.
That's it. And yeah, and they've got no competition as well. That's just it. Like you're saying, no egos, because there'll be companies in Glasgow that maybe some companies in Glasgow will be running the same weekends, and then some people may have a choice to go to this one or that one. But no, like I'm saying, if you go to Caithness, you're going to Combat League. That's what's happening. You don't really have either or, unless W3L go up once a year, but even then they don't tend to clash anyway, so it all kind of works out.
Yeah.
I mean, much like here, I mean, my only option really, even though Wrestling Experience Scotland was here last weekend, they're up in Inverness last weekend, and I was in Inverness that weekend seeing Alan Carr, so that was a very weird day. I could have went to the wrestling, but no, I'm seeing Alan Carr instead in Inverness. It was That was the competition for Wrestling Experience Scotland. So unfortunately, Alan Carr won because they'd already bought the tickets. But no, yes, out of the sticks, you're really few and far between. For myself, it's WrestleZone or whoever comes to Inverness, or again, W3L if they come once a year. That's about it. And it just makes you appreciate going to wrestling more, because you're like, this is all I've got, unless I want to travel 6 hours to get to a show. And I'll be honest, it has to be an absolutely mind-blowing, never going to happen again show for me to even consider it. So
that's very fair.
No, I've done my time. I drove down to Edinburgh once for a show and back the same night. That was it. That was plenty. Fine. Not needing that again. I'll navigate it. I'm still waiting. Whenever Kelly wants to go down to Edinburgh again, I'm still going to try and like navigate it so it's a discovery weekend, just on the off chance, you know, just look, there's wrestling on. We should just go to that. I didn't know the show was on. We should go.
Oh, crept up on us, yeah.
I can't believe it. Oh, I think Jack Jester's on the show. Really? No, but I mean, if I keep telling you, I might get you to go. That's her favorite. Her favorite is Jack Jester. Looking sharp, second. Very weird mix when it comes to wrestlers. Right. So speaking of Combat League, we've got an excellent question from Daniel Mejka. I probably said wrong again, so I apologize, Daniel, for the second time. Brodie, why do you keep beating up Albion de Quincey? Is there not room for two poets in CLW? And how do you see your match with Eric Arkham against ADQ and RJ Cash going at the next show in Thurso?
Three-part, very easy question. So I'll weigh in on the two poets part first. Firstly, I have no intention of being a second poet of Caithness. I just know I do it better because I am published. That is all there is to it. I was a published poet when I was 9 years old, and I will go to the grave with that. So I'm holding that over him. But I don't want to be a crappy poet, so he can take that. Why do I keep battering Albion de Quincey? Because Combat League keep on booking me against them. Literally, I've had three matches and they have all had Albion de Quincey in them. And if I want to win my match, I'll need to batter Albion de Quincey. It just happens to be so much fun and very easy.
Fair enough. Right, I'm going to need to know about the more published poet thing, just a little bit more. I realised somehow in our setting up of this meeting, I think I put you in the meeting twice, so we'll probably have a break in about 9 minutes and then come back in and carry on the episode. So just okay. In case anyone watches the episode and there's a break, it's not a technical difficulty, it's just me not knowing how to use Zoom. So we've got like 9 minutes or so to talk about published poet. Tell me more.
It was just this daft thing. So I was brought up in Renfrewshire, and there was like this scheme that the Renfrewshire Council were doing when I was in like, I think I was maybe in primary six. And it was basically like, let's get all the primary school kids to write poems and we'll put them in a book. And that is as simple as that. It's not even like a pure proper book. It's just a book of primary school kids' poems that was published by the Renfrewshire Council, but it was still published. My name's still in there. So I've got that up on them. Mine's was about kittens.
Do you remember any of it, or just subject matter?
Dude, I've got the book in my room.
That's right. Well, that's the tease for the next part. I'm trying to think. I think it must have been a nationwide thing, because for some reason I don't remember anything about doing it, but I'm fairly certain that our school did it as well, back in Rothes, of all places, which, you know, the standards weren't that high. I think one was mine, if I did one, was probably one of the better ones. Not to stroke my own ego, because we were just a load of thick kids in Rothes. So yeah, that seems to... So I need to find out more about that. Mum's got a diary of like 20 years.
It's called sure Poetic Voyages, if that rings any bells with you.
No, I just remember a red book. Which I don't know if that's just something weird from my memory of the bank that I'll have a nightmare about tonight about something else. But that is literally what I'm going to be thinking about for the next wee while after we've wrapped up recording. So yeah, look, I want to see that once we come back from wherever this 7 minutes thing hits off. I want to hear it if you don't mind.
So, I was only 9, so I suppose I can let it slide, yeah.
I mean, I'm hoping not any dark material then. If it's about kittens, I'm hoping it's going to be nice and fluffy, but, you know, you never know. 9-year-olds, they have active imagination, probably. So I'll go for another question then. We've got Martin Alexander, obviously the saviour of doing results, because I've always excited when he goes to a show. Like, I'm at the show tonight, like, yes, my results. Easy. I don't have to actually contact anyone the way I like it. He just asked, favourite metal bands?
I'm just going to list a bunch of my favourite bands then, because sometimes when you list a band that you think's metal, other people are like, that's not metal. So, Pantera, obviously. Metallica. I would say Skindred are kind of metal because they're like kind of dub metal in a way, kind of dub punk metal rock. I don't really know. My goodness, what bands do I like? I don't know. I'm very eclectic in my taste. Like, I can literally go from like Newton Faulkner to Manic Street Preachers to like Pantera and stuff. So, I think I'm more into like my kind of dirty rock and roll, like Calio and like Royal Blood. They're like my favorite band just now. A band I didn't realize that I liked until the weekend was Kiss, who I've never really listened to before, but their performance was just mad. It was absolutely mental. To see a 72-year-old man spitting blood on a stage dressed as a demon is something that I will never, ever unsee. And to see a 75-year-old man on a zip line with a guitar in his arm, like, I don't know how they were doing it, but it's... I mean, I'm 31 and I can barely get out of bed in the morning. So, but yeah, my favourites would be Skin Dread, The Blackout, or Matt. Actually, you have to do that. Blackout, Skin Dread, Pantera, Metallica, like a bit of Faith No More. And then it's like Green Day and My Chemical Romance, Blink-182 and stuff. I'm sorry, my cat's wrecking the place because he's not getting attention off me just now. And I'm just back from leaving for 5 days.
That'll do it. If my dog just ignores me now. She's like sick of me. I've been working for 2 years now. She comes in every so often and sighs. Like, what are you doing? Go away. And I'll leave for 5 minutes. She'll be like, oh my God, you'd be gone forever. And then go, fucking you. I'm going to go back to sleep then. I think you mentioned the Blackout before in a previous episode. I think it was one of your tattoos, was it?
Yeah, that's my wee, on my very, very red arms. It's my wee square.
How was it?
Yeah.
Mind you did talk about them. It became familiar. There's some of them bands I just kind of glazed over because I'm going, yep. That's all cool. But no, Kiss, yeah, that's I don't know what it is about Kiss. I like some of their songs. If they came on the radio, I wouldn't like go out of my way to listen to them, but they got ruined for me a little bit. I don't know if you've seen the film Role Models with Sean William Scott, and yeah, so it's every time I hear them I just think they want to rock and roll all night and a part of every day, and that's just that's it forever. that's them ruined. And Kelly hasn't seen the film, but I've said that so many times now, I've ruined it for her as well. She doesn't need to see it, because every time I go rock and roll all night and a part of every day.
I mean, for me, it was Gene Simmons' reality TV show that ruined it for me. it just made me never ever really want to listen to them, because he was just such an ass. Kind of like watching Hogan Knows Best. That was an eye-opener when I went back to that a couple of weeks ago.
Oh, that's a brave choice, revisiting Hogan Knows Best, when you find out, because, no, he didn't.
I think it's because Brian Zane was talking about it, and I was like, I'm really curious now. So we stuck it on, and I was just like, oh my God, dude, can you get away from your daughter, please? Like, just leave her alone. It's a bit much.
I mean, I'm fairly certain he's got enough money from Gawker that he's not going to sue me for saying Hogan Knows Incest. But, you know, moving on. It's me that said it, for anyone listening, from Hogan's representatives. But, you know, stay away from her arse. That was a bit weird with the whole pictures of her getting sun cream on her. Like, you know, sell. Hogan, Jesus.
Oh, man, I don't feel too good.
right, we've got 2 minutes left of the meeting. I'll end the meeting, and then I want you to go get that poetry book, and we'll restart again, hopefully with no further interruptions, because I'll finally learn how to use Zoom, maybe.
Okay, good luck.
I'll be back in a sec.
Cool.
Welcome back. I think we've sorted it now, hopefully. But for you guys, it was mere seconds. For us, it was just mere minutes of anticipation, because I want to hear this poem about kittens.
Oh my gosh, this is the worst thing. I thought I remembered what page I was on. Oh, I think I'm on page 64. That's really bad.
That's fine, that's the best page, clearly. That's the one everyone wants to get onto.
There's one called Nintendo Dino the Dinosaur, yes.
Oh, I'm liking this already. Is it?
What school did I go to? Oh. Right, we're going to have to just... Oh, it's 142, isn't it? Apparently I'm just going to keep on guessing numbers.
Is it not like an index?
Oh my God, I was right. I remembered the page number.
So, for the first time in many a year, we're going to We're going to hear the poetry of the published poet, Brodie Adler.
Oh my gosh. My one threatening wrestlers was much better. Kittens. Why are you doing this to me, Billy? Kittens are playful, funny, and sweet. You'll never know what they want to eat. Your house will never be the same. After a few days, you'll go insane. Let me tell you, they're hard to handle, and it will also turn into a little vandal. Wait till Mum and Dad see what you've done, although after a while, they're a lot of fun. Kittens always go so mad. When it finds your toys, you'll be pretty sad. If it eats a lot when it's growing into a cat, you must expect it to be quite fat. Man, I sucked.
You know what? It was all factual. I assume as a cat owner, I assume that's factual to you. It all came true.
Yeah, he breaks my stuff. It goes mental. He's a bit chonky. It's pretty much on the money. It was, if anything, it was a factual piece.
I was going to turn around and go, oh, no, I don't think we recorded any of that. We have to do it again. But
cruel.
So, yeah, when we arranged this episode, you didn't think you'd be reading your own poetry.
I did not, no.
Wonderful. That's made my night. Here we go. We can pack up now. Pack up now. No, we've got loads more to speak about, I'm sure. So we talked about getting back into wrestling then. We've talked about your matches and what have you. But one that kind of like is out there that caught my eye was you getting your debut down in England, according to Cage Match. Whether that, yeah, you debuted beforehand, but for the Uprawl Championship Wrestling Women's title, you were wrestling Emily Hayden.
Yeah, that's right, Newcastle.
So that's across the border, technically another country. Who knows? Give it another year, maybe it will be actually another proper country. But what was it like getting the debut across the border?
Oh, it was awesome. I felt like it was like a week and a. We kind of mini milestone for me. It was lovely. The match was a lot of fun as well. It was tough because Emily Hayden, as you know, is such a big character. So trying to meet her energy and come up a little bit was really, really tough. But we had a good match. We had a lot of fun. Emily obviously retained. Yeah, that's the word. Retained her championship. But it was good, and I was really, really grateful, like, for the opportunity, especially from a promoter that I hadn't really spoken to before. So it was really, really cool just to be like, yeah, I've crossed the border now. Maybe I can sneak back over eventually as well. It'd be lovely. But yeah, it was really, really cool, man. I enjoyed it.
I mean, if you're going on a technicality, you're now an international wrestler. if you want to be technical, an international wrestler / poet. We've got you now. I'm not going to forget that, unfortunately.
Nah, never going to leave me.
No, when this episode comes out, I'm hoping that people just send you some poetry, you know, just not the same one, obviously, that'd be plagiarism, but you know, just their own poets poetry about kittens and cats.
As long as it's not Albie and De Quincey, I'll be happy. His poem's stuck.
So is it just I think you said it was just a school thing, so you're kind of forced into doing it. But is that something that you've kind of went back to at all? And well, obviously you did it for your wrestling promo, but is that a creative outlet that you like? Of course, you're in a band, so you did a bit of songwriting, I'm guessing, as well.
Yeah, I was in bands for a while. So yeah, I'd done like songwriting and stuff. I do have a wee book that I have written stuff in. I've not done it in a long time because I kind of feel like I'm probably just too lazy. It's something I would like to do, just kind of to jot stuff down, but yeah, I used to write songs for the bands I was in and stuff, which was good fun. But I just, like, to be honest, like, I kind of feel like without that outlet now, I just never really saw purpose for it. But I guess if it's a nice wee thing to do on the side, I could totally get back into it, because I do sit with like my notepad on my phone. Obviously I'm not writing stuff, like I'm not in school. So I'll just sit and write random stuff on my notepad, really. But I suppose I could muster up some linguistics, is that the word? I don't think I'll be able to do it, man. I've forgotten English, like, honestly.
I mean my only poetry comes from limericks. I can maybe do a mean limerick, and it literally is a mean limerick, usually swearing and somewhere involved somewhere with it, you know, in the ones was mad from Nantucket, you know, all that kind of stuff. But yeah, I did, there was like a week in school where my mate he played a guitar and I wrote a song. It was about a cheese toastie. I don't remember it, but I remember enough of it to never say out loud. We put it on Bebo.
Oh, wow.
I know, it was my featured video for a week. And then I took it down and it disappeared, never to be seen again, because I uploaded it to Bebo. So not like I uploaded it to YouTube to put on Bebo, it was uploaded directly there. But no, it was a terrible song about a cheese toastie. And
you write love songs basically if it's about a cheese toastie.
Well, I mean, I named lots of cheeses. That's pretty much as close as I got to.
Erotic to me.
About cheddar and Edam and other stuff. So that was my songwriting career. I did write a song about a turtle once. They all had the same tune. So really, it was less songwriting, more than just filling in words to the same beat over and over again. But I don't know why I'm telling you this, but I feel like I need to give you something embarrassing about myself now that I've made you read your kitten poem. I think it seems fair for me to go, I did something embarrassing too, even though yours is way better than
it's not song. The same. I didn't get to hear yours.
You don't. I'll see if I can get hold of my mate. I will see if he still has it, because he's that kind of person that'll keep everything. But it's not my proudest work. We did this is gonna sound even worse, sadder actually. We did photos, like,
finish that sentence, Billy.
We did photos that we were gonna use for cover art for a band, and they were taken in Dufton Park, and so they were taken in a play park. And I was wearing, I can tell you exactly what I was wearing, because I actually still have a photo of it. I was wearing like beige, like combat trousers, you know, with the zips and everything. So pure beige, no camo, just beige. And a white and brown hoodie, you know, sexy. I had full head of hair, 3 whiskers on my top lip. And I can just remember the photo because I was just standing in the middle distance like this.
Yes.
And because my mate was in charge of the camera, he didn't know how to work the timer. So the one decent, I use that very loosely, decent photo is me in the middle distance like that and him running towards me because he fucked up the timer. So it's the worst thing ever. It's just, yeah, it's awful.
So you think you've still got this?
I'm fairly certain I still have it somewhere. If I don't have that exact photo, I've got a right when I left. When I left Rothes when I was 17, with me and this mate hung about in Last Day, and my other friend, and we recreated the back to back arms thing for no other reason than I was 17 and I was an idiot. So. And at that point, oh, it was even better. At that point, I cut my hair, but I had frosted tips.
Wow. Dude. I mean, I've had some band photo shoots in my time, but I've never done folded arm back-to-back photos with frosted tips.
It was a wonderful time. How naive. I hadn't drank at that point. It was very clear. I was sober, actually, now I'm saying that. Yeah, I did it sober. I was just like, yeah, this is a cool idea. Let's do that. But no, there's so many bad pictures from that particular last day. Anyway, let's move on. I don't want any more questions about this from anyone. So let's just... If I do find them, though, I think, like I say, for the sake of embarrassment, I will send at least one to you. But no more. I'll just pick the best or the worst, whatever I decide is at the time. Right. So we've got Suzanne. I think we may have answered this in a previous episode, but I don't know if your answer's changed since. She's asked, if it hasn't already been covered on your previous episode, favourite dinosaur and why?
Having been at Download at the weekend, I'm going to say the T-Rex that crowd surfs every weekend at Download. They're the big blow-up T-Rex dolls that look like they're like really struggling to walk about.
Yeah.
I love those like so, so much. And there's always a few at Download, but see when they crowd surf, like, it's just outstanding. I'm pretty sure there was one crowd surfing on like a blow-up air mattress last year. Just some of the stuff you see is outstanding. So I'm just going to have to say, like, every blow-up T-Rex dinosaur costume ever, because the videos of them, just, they absolutely crack me up, man. I just love them. They're so good. I do like a wee Triceratops, but...
I think that was your answer last time, Triceratops. That seems familiar.
It sure was.
But no, but blow up T-Rex, that's an absolutely fine answer. I'm liking people just going outside the box. Matt Wolf's now got my new favourite, even though Harney Skies won for ages with Turkey Dinosaur. His favourite was the invisible dinosaur. Do you think he saw us? And that is just beautiful. I don't know if I'm going to be a dad soon, or the dad puns just they hit different now. They're just like, yes, I will have that one straight away.
They seem to be more acceptable the more deep into your 30s you get, don't they?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Give me a good dad joke or a pun. I love a pun. I'm always working out. So between all that, then of course you got a match with Aisha Raymond as well. That was Clyde Valley Wrestling's debut show. So a lot going into that. It was I spoke to Craig the week of that show, and it sounded like he was working on a well-oiled machine. He had belts. He had very nice looking belts as well, which is
always good. Yeah, the belts are pretty. Yeah, they're very pretty.
And I hate seeing like new companies going, this is our belt, and it's like that one where it all looks the same. It's got the outline, and then it's just got their logo in the middle. I'm like, at least make a little bit of an effort, you know. Just, I mean, some companies still have those belts and they look great. I'm not judging them, but you know, just if you're going for, if you're going to like go for it, just fucking go for it.
If you're going to make a belt for your new company, just go balls out the bath with it. Like, make it yours.
Cracking turn of phrase. So a match with Aisha then. So you've already had hard hitting opponents like Regina. I've had hard hitting opponents like ADM as well. Oh, no, you teamed the ADM. Incorrect. Hammer and Sickle. You had a big match with two big lags, Hammer and Sickle. But Aisha Raymond's a whole different kettle of fish because she's the Amazon for a reason. And so what was it like getting in the ring? Because someone you've trained with, someone who has kind of mentored you a little bit. What was it like getting in the ring with Aisha?
It was interesting, yeah. As someone that I had looked up to for... quite a lot of time, and that I had trained with previously and stuff, like it was really, really good. I felt like it was a kind of test in a way, especially from when I was at the dojo and stuff. Like she would train me on like very like it was very kind of like sprinkle on top stuff that she was training me, like how to hold myself and how to go against like smaller opponents and bigger opponents. So I felt like I could take a lot of this into the match, and I could be like, right, I can show you what I've taken from you, and I can show you that I have learned, and this is what I can do. And it was really, really good. I took my first man, I really have a terrible memory. I remember looking back on the other podcast and it was bad, but Christ alive. Yeah, I took my first. Oh my gosh! Right, I'm just going to brush over that.
Was that a power bomb? Was it?
Yes, it was a power bomb.
I only got that just for reading this. Wait, I'm guessing power bomb somewhere.
It's absolutely unreal, honestly. Like, I'm just going to blame the lack of sleep. Like, I'm currently like chugging a full blue spark. So,
keep me going.
I know, hardcore.
Clean, energize, and clean your sink at the same time.
It was good. The place was absolutely packed. It was great for a first show for Clyde Valley, and it was really good because we got to, it wasn't just a pure good wrestling match between us. Like, we got to kind of play off each other and be the old kind of like boo bad guy and yay good guy stuff. So it was a lot of fun, as well as like a good learning curve and a nice wee hat in the bonnet and stuff. So it was cool. Yeah, it was a good experience.
So for the EA boost, you still a good guy, for lack of a better term, you still a good guy in Clyde Valley as well, or is Combat League your only dark zone when it comes to Brodie Adler?
Combat League's pretty much the only dark zone I got at the moment, and that's why I'm going very, very balls to the wall with it. Like, I want to do as much with it as possible. I want to challenge myself with it, and I feel like it's something that I can show people I can do this, but I can also do this, and I can pull that stuff out the bag. And I feel like it's, I don't want to sound like I'm being like smug or anything, but I feel like it's something that not many of the other girls on the scene are really doing at the moment, with like the mad makeup and just the daft over the topness of it. So it's something I want to do that makes me a bit more like different, stand out a bit more. And it's for fun. Like, I get to go in and just be this mad crazy bitch, and it's good fun. So yeah, good girl in Clyde Valley, and it was good. Nice to have the cheating and stuff back, because I kind of missed it after going to Combat League.
That's the thing, you're talking about the freedom to do that, to explore those sides of Brodie Adler. I was speaking to Nicole Jasmine yesterday. That was the yesterday one I recorded, and we were talking about like gimmicks or what she wanted to do, and she was like, she can do cartwheels and flips and stuff like that, which is not something a lot of girls could do on their own in Scotland anyway. So she kind of got, she has that as her little like sprinkle of something extra. And yeah, yourself, you've got, there's not many people like you. Well, I'm just going to say that, right? There's not many people like Brodie Adler in Scotland or possibly even the UK right now. But at least if you've got both sides, like, adaptable, so if you can fit into any spot that's required on a show, so they can go, oh, we need this big badass scary beast. Oh, give me a second, I've got my makeup, I'll just put some stuff on the side of my face, I'm all good, I'll do that. Or they need this like the fun loving person. Oh, I can do that, that's fine, I can do it all. So it's great that people are getting, like yourself, getting opportunities to explore that side of them, because Like I said, with knowing things about Combat League, without nerds like myself, there's not that many people that'll know what's happening in each part of the country. So you can do one thing in one place and do it in another place, but those audiences may never cross at all. So it's a very fulfilling and creative experience, I assume wrestling is, for yourself to do that.
Like, I feel like one of the things I've been a bit nervous about is it's kind of coming across as, like, for lack of a better phrase, a one-trick pony. Like, I don't want to have that at all. Like, I'm very aware that I'm getting into wrestling at a kind of later on stage. You've got the girls, like, you've got, like, Angel Hayes and like Ashley Vega and Rosie Knight and stuff. They're all, like, in their early 20s, kind of late, like, their teens and stuff when they came in. And I debuted when I think I was 28. Was I 28? Yeah. I was 28 when I debuted. And then we had like a 2-year gap. So I'm 31 now, and this is me just kind of starting to get out into the wrestling world in Scotland anyway. So I'm very aware that I'm starting at a later age, and I don't want just to be like, oh, I can come out and be like Brodie. That's it. Like, I'd like to have some other stuff up my sleeve. So for people who don't go to Combat League and don't get to see me in that light, I'd like the promos that I put out to kind of give a bit more, like, oh, so she's doing stuff like that, but they can't see me in motion of it. Like I done the promo for the most recent Combat League show, and it was like the kind of Two-Face theme when I was like in the forest and stuff. And it was a lot of fun to do, because I felt like I was kind of pushing Brodie's boundaries a bit, and it wasn't just a me sitting in front of a camera talking about this show and this is what I'm going to do and that's that person. Mm-hmm. I felt like it brought me out of my comfort zone a bit, and it can show that I can do other things if you need me to, and I will, and I'm just trying to get a bit more, like, a bit more different stuff under my hat, I guess, that I can offer. Like you said, like, if you need a big badass bitch, I can do that. If you need a happy clappy girl, I can do that. If you need this, I can do that. Like, I've brought so many hats in my suitcase. Whichever one you need me to put on, I'll do it.
And like you say with the promos as well, production is I find such an important thing nowadays in wrestling, because social media is, back when I started watching Scottish wrestling, even that was 2012, which makes me feel so fucking old every time I say that. But there was not much. There was maybe, and you still get it nowadays, like you're saying, just in front of a blank wall, time, date, place, opponent. I'm going to beat you. Time, date, place, opponent. And that's it. But if you put in a little bit more production values, like you've done with your recent promos, it stands out straight away. It's like, well, I'm willing to put in the effort to do go the extra mile to make myself look like great on these promos, which automatically lifts a show up, because they need to kind of match. There's match your kind of production, because if you do an amazing produced promo, and then you go onto their Facebook page and it's a really shit graphic that they've got up to go with it, then you look great, they don't. So they need to up their game to match what you're bringing at the same time. So it's, I didn't realize how big social media was until I started doing the tournaments, because I was hearing, like, even off the back of those things with promos and stuff like that, that the folk were getting bookings off it, or at least were getting noticed by companies off it. I'm like, I didn't realize that could be a thing, but that's just realized how imperative social media is now to wrestling.
Oh, absolutely. I fully believe that the tournaments is how I'm in the position that I'm in just now, because I got to meet other people and I got to put out promos and I got some more followers and stuff. Like, if I didn't do the Scott Rest tournaments, I think it would be completely different what I'm doing just now. I do. I think I would be in source. That's it.
But that's it. Like you say, well, you met Manifold, of course, and he's got a little less experience than you, I suppose, beyond shows. But when I was speaking to him for the episode with him, he's got such a like creative mind that people, you wouldn't realize, because he hasn't wrestled or hasn't been on wrestling shows for that long. But you could probably pick quite a bit off just his surface ideas and have something amazing come out of it. So. There's just a lot of hidden gems. I'm thankful that I was able to kind of put some to the forefront and they were able to do that. And it really, it was all off the back of me just being bored one day and going, oh, I remember Five Star Wrestling and their 128-man tournament. Let's do that on Twitter. That was it. That was the whole idea behind it. So, that was cool to do. And I'm glad that I got to speak to yourself as well, because a lot of the people that were on the podcast, they're on the first couple episodes anyway, it was all people that I'd met or that had really taken advantage of the tournaments and did these things. I'm like, oh, they seem cool. I'll get them on this podcast thing I'm doing, because clearly they're sound enough to jump in on this ridiculous concept of a Twitter pool tournament thing. They must be cool enough to at least speak to me for half an hour or something. So, you know, and from that, I've spoken to you, like, what's that, 5 times now between podcasts and quizzes and preview shows and all that kind of stuff, and
yeah, maybe 5 or 6, yeah.
And prior to that, I don't think anyone heard you speak.
No.
So, weird. So yeah, it's a nice thing. I'm coming to the end of this season in particular. I'm kind of like just going back over the stuff I've done in the last 2 years anyway, since the podcast began, and going, you know, I did okay. Did all right with this. I think I made a difference.
You may be modest about it, Billy. You can be pure, yes, I've done this and it was great and people have benefited and it's been cracking.
That's because I'm sober. Give me three beers and I'll probably be just like going, yeah, I held Scottish Wrestling together. I held it together for 2 years while everyone was either getting cancelled or near wrestling. I held it together. But no,
I'm going to cut that wee bit out of the recording and use it completely out of context just for fun.
That's fine. You would do better than I do. I'm awful. I'm thinking the podcast would be better if I actually took the time and effort to clip bits out to put out as a preview, I never remember it, and I never do. And it just always comes and goes, here's a new episode. People have to listen to it all because I'm not clipping anything out of it. You've got to go listen to it now.
Keeps the mystery.
I know, I've started doing it. I've gone through season one and starting clipping bits out again. So I'll have to go back through your episode and see what we discussed, if there's anything that I need to
put out there. Shy the world.
Oh, just that once season five is in the preliminary in the starting stages, I will just cut out your poem. That'll be the one of the preview bits. But no, I'll put out the shambles singing is going to go out in July after the thing wraps up, because it's the worst thing I've ever done on the podcast.
I think I've watched that shambles episode about four times now, man. Oh, I loved it. I thought it was so much fun.
I went back, finally watched it, the whole singing segment, and it's honestly the worst thing. I just felt so bad for the guys that were on it. Like, what have I done? I had to coerce you into singing on this episode, and then I had to start it, which was even worse. And it was, oh, no.
And you're getting poetry out of people and stuff from their childhood. Look at the power you hold.
I know. I don't get it. I don't understand. I think it's just because I'm not a journalist. I'm not here for a scoop. I'm not here for, this is my social time. I'm going to have a chat with someone that I kind of half know, at least on a surface level on social media and through these chats. I'm like, let's have a chat for a bit. There might be some wrestling. Who cares? Let's just have a laugh for a bit and ask about dinosaurs and shit. Anyway, that's enough about me. I think I've went on to a good wee tangent of just, ain't I great? But be modest about it at the same time. Let's get back to Brodie Adler. Right, so we've got a few things about planning matches coming through on the old social medias. I don't know if you got any directly through your Instagram at all, but I'm just going through comments you got on your post itself. I've got that nerdy powerlifter asking, how much planning goes into a match with your opponent?
So I saw this comment, and respectfully, I would rather not answer it. Cool. I would like to keep a bit of, like,
some of the magic.
Yeah, come on, like, I
no
mean,
bother.
I would kind of think, like, my, can I use the word peers in wrestling? Mm-hmm. I would like to think that my peers would also be like, I'm not answering that. Like, cool. Like, no offense to the guy, like, I appreciate you've asked the question, but you, like, I would like to have the benefit of the doubt and not think that it's a loaded question.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like, nah, man, let's keep some magic in it. Like, kayfabe might be gone, but let's not shit on our grave. So
if that that nerdy powerlifter wants to find out, really, he's going to have to get training and find out for himself. Fair. Like I say, not a journalist. I'm moving on. You've asked not to answer it. Right. So we've got Ruby Roberts here. Even after we just went, you get all this stuff out of guests, and I'm like going, what's this? No.
I know. Like, that's just one of the ones that I'm just like, oh, well, we're more kind of worth it. Like, I'm not.
Yeah, that's cool. So I've got Ruby Roberts asking, like, a three-pronged amazing question. So we may have to take one at a time. So she asks, if you had to plan three matches, but they would be, one, who do you want to fight right now?
Right now, I would really like to fight Ruby again. I had a really great match with her in W3L, and it was tough. I had a great time, but man, that bitch hits you like she's rough, and I loved it. I really enjoyed it. I would really like a match with Ashley Vega. I've been gunning for a match with Ashley Vega for a while. Unfortunately, we've just not managed to cross paths. My absolute number one wanting a match with has got to be Taylor Veit, because I love everything about him. He's just absolutely fine. I genuinely believe he is one of Scotland's best wrestlers at the moment. I think he's just absolutely fantastic. He's not only a brilliant wrestler, but his character is so good that I hate him. I hate that guy. I hate him, but I love him, but I hate him. Like, so yeah, if I'm out of the top three.
It's one of those, like, you can just tweak one thing and it can be the biggest babyface reaction of all time, or he just tweaks it one way and it's the absolute pits, the biggest arsehole in the world.
Exactly.
Just for one thing. It's incredible. It's like that Kurt Angle thing where he came out as the good, he thought he was the good guy, but everyone booed him. He didn't understand why. It's because he was too perfect. But if he dialed it back, everyone would cheer him. It's amazing. I love it. I love like how much effort people put into their characters in wrestling, because if someone gets it, then it's the best thing in the world. But if they don't get it, then they get to learn at the same time. It's just, it's amazing. I love wrestling.
Yeah. I just fully like, I don't want to suck up too much because I'll never hear the end of it, man. But just seeing how he can just feed off a crowd so well. I love watching him work when he's not wrestling, and I love watching him wrestle. And that's just absolutely everything I need in a wrestler. And it absolutely baffles me that he's not more places than what he is right now. It does. But like, that's why wrestling's subjective, isn't it? Like, I can have one opinion and other people can have different ones.
Cool. Next one of this three-pronged approach, trident, I suppose. Who do you want to fight in the next 5 years?
I haven't really thought about who I want to fight. I more think about kind of places I want to fight. I would love a match with Clementine. I think she's just brilliant. I love Clementine. She's a fantastic wrestler, and again, like, she's just so lovable and sweet, and I would love to batter that out of her, I think, but in like the nicest way. Like, I think she's cracking. I think she's brilliant. Feed me to anyone. Like, I just want to wrestle people and wrestle in places. But yeah, if I could, and if within the next 5 years, if I could get good enough and get enough like traction behind me to like wrestle in a place like Pro Wrestling Eve or in Wrestle Carnival, I would love to have Clementine.
I'll squeeze the juices out. And the third part of that is, who is your ultimate career goals match? Who would you pick?
Jesus, Ruby, absolutely killing me here.
I know, amazing questions. Coming in the last minute as well. This isn't the last request for questions.
Oh my goodness.
Killed it.
I don't know. I feel like there's a lot of people I really like that I would like to have matches with, but I would need to feel like I'm at that level first. Like, I feel like I'm still very much down at a beginner's level, because I'm only just in the door. I would love, obviously I'd love a match with Clementine. People like Jetta. I would love a match with Jetta and Rhea O'Reilly and like Nina Samuels. Charles Crowley is currently like my favourite wrestler in the UK, because he's got absolutely everything. He's got everything that a wrestler kind of, if you were to have like a bag and you were like, right, what will I put in this to make a wrestler? You would just Crowley. Like, I would love a match with him. I think that'd be really cool. And I would like to be able to stand toe-to-toe with those people in the next 5 years, I'd think.
So all time though, who's your kind of, I'll get the big fantasy question out of the way at this point, because it seems like the best place to put it. So Vince McMahon phones you up. Yeah, Vince McMahon phones you up. He goes, or insert biggest name, Tony Khan, if you want. Even though he probably doesn't phone you, he probably just texts you. You know, awkward. But you know, he tweets you, DMs you. Vince McMahon phones. He wants to book you in the main event of WrestleMania. He's been watching all those SWN podcasts. He's like, I really want to get this Brodie Adler on here, even though she had a meltdown in the Day of Birth bonanza the first time. Will it happen the second time? Who knows? Someone book you. You get to pick your stipulation, pick the opponent or opponents. You total control of the match. My only request is they have to be alive. I don't have the money to regenerate people. What is it?
Not yet.
Yeah.
He'll get Hulk back one day once he's dead.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. Probably got him on ice. Have you heard from Hulk Hogan in a while?
Fortunately not.
No, just reliving him Maybe that it's taking a dark turn. Let's kind of real. anyway, yes. I've got the mighty regenerate people yet. Who's in the match?
I've got to say Awesome Kong, because she's just awesome. She's just like, I love her. I love her so much. If I could have a match with Awesome Kong and Bull Nakano and make it like a street fight, it would need to be my retirement match though, because I would not come back from that. That would be so cool. That'd be amazing.
Well, fine. Easy. Street fight, triple threat, Bull Nakano, Awesome Kong, Brodie Adler. I don't know if the ring could handle it, but that's why street fight. Perfect. Any particular, like, because street fight, sometimes back in the day, they'd end up actually on the streets. Is there any particular venue you'd want to go for? Is like, would you want it home turf? Would you want it any particular city? Where would you want to have that street fight?
Not doable, but the first place to get my head there would be the Catty. Like, I don't know if you've been in the Cat House, but there's just so many obstacles and chains and stuff. Like, it would be mental. But the ceilings are really low. So, but I don't imagine any of us would be doing any high flying. And if we do, it'll be down the stairs of the Cat House.
I've heard the reputation precedes the Cat House. I've never actually been in it. Like, last time I was in Glasgow, it was for McFly. Which automatically, I think, kind of disqualifies me from the Cat House. but
you'd be surprised, they do play McFly in the Cat House.
But seeing the queue, because I usually, if I'm in Glasgow, I'll go to Box. That's like, I like that. I like Box.
I do like Box.
Even though last time I went, I got one of their cocktail things and my tongue like grew twice the size. So I think I'm allergic to something in one of their cocktails.
What was it?
I don't know. It was a red one.
Narrows it down.
I know, strawberry something. I like strawberry, so it must be strawberry cocktail of some description.
Are you daiquiri or something?
It must have been. I like a daiquiri, but yeah, I drank it and then Kelly looked at me going, "You all right?" And I went, "Yep, fine." Oh, I don't think I'm fine. And I'm still drinking it. I was like, I paid for it. I'm still drinking this thing. If they're gonna kill me, I'll be all right.
Next time you go, just get a Bucky Bomb. That'll sort you out.
Well, that's why we went, because the first time we went, we the ICW still game hot cocktails. We were so excited. And
yeah.
I got the Kenny, whatever Kenny Williams one was at the time. I think it was like some sort of shark bite kind of thing. It was really nice, yeah. Anyway. It's like coconut. But yeah, that's why we went back last time, and I don't think they were there, so we had to just pick one of the cocktails instead. And like I say, some idiot had an allergic reaction to it. Hours before going to see McFly, so I had a good day.
I guess you couldn't sing along to all their great songs then.
Oh, I tried. I was screaming along. I was all about it. Knew all the words, because of course I did. So the last question we have through all the social medias that I have anyway is through Instagram. We've got Crispy Mac, which is an excellent handle. I like it.
Crispy.
It's a bit of a deep question, I suppose. What do you think the state of Scottish wrestling will be in the next 5 years?
God, if it's anything to do with my brush with wrestling in the past few months, hopefully brilliant. Hopefully much cleaner anyway. I think it's very hard to say, because Scottish wrestling scene has changed so much just in the past like 2 years, 3 years alone. And it's been like, it's quite scary. Just how much, I mean, I say how much thing, I know people are going to be watching this like, well, you weren't there, and it's like, well, no, I wasn't, I was a fan. Mm-hmm. But I would hope for more. I would hope for it to be more equal. There are still wrestling companies in Glasgow, in the greater Glasgow area, and in Scotland not doing women's matches. Like, they will have a show without a woman on the card, without a woman on the poster. And I'm just like, what is your reason for that? Like, when you look at the amount of women that are in Scotland at the moment, like, you've got Emerson Jane, you've got Debbie Dahmer, Ruby Roberts, Emily Hayden, myself, Cassie King, Nicole Jasmine, Rosie Knight, who I keep going to call her by her shoot name, Ashley Vega, like Angel Hayes,
Anastasia,
Guy, Anastasia,
Molly Spartan,
Molly Spartan, Ellie Armstrong, like you've got the Struthers sisters, you've got, I've run out of fingers like three times. You've got so many women on this scene. You have zero excuse not to have one on your card. And you know what? If you've got one on your card, why don't you have two? Why don't you have three or four? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm a big follower of Pro Wrestling Eve, and Dan Reed put out a really good post about you've got no excuse to have less than like half your card of women. And he's totally right, because like that's me listing just Scottish wrestlers. Think about how many you've got in Britain. Mm-hmm. If we can bring up people from the UK, from the UK, we are the UK at the moment, but if you can bring up loads of women from England, then men, my God, I'm going to try that one again. If you can bring up loads of men from England, like why can't you bring up people like Lucia Lee or Rio mm-hmm. or Jetta or anyone like that? What's stopping you from bringing these people up? And unfortunately, I feel like I kind of do know the answer. And it's because, like, it's either, one, can it be arsed? Which I kind of get the vibe that it's sometimes can it be arsed. Two, they're not one of the boys. They're not my pal. Like, mm-hmm. they're not easily accessible. Or three, just ignorance and laziness. And I know this is going to come off as a bit of a shoot, and it might get me a little bit of snash. I'm absolutely okay with that. Like, it's not fair that I'm still seeing posters for wrestling shows like in my postcode which don't have women in them, and I'm not saying that it should be me on that card, absolutely not. Like, it just needs to be someone. It needs to be better. Companies are very good about screaming about how they've got safeguarding stuff in place now and they've got separate locker rooms. And it's like, what's the point in you having a separate locker room if you've got one person taking up the other side? Mm-hmm. It really rubs me up the wrong way. And that's one thing I would really, really like to see change in Scottish wrestling. Will it change? I kind of wish I could be more confident in the answer, but I really hope it does, man. I hope it does, because there's so many amazing women who deserve the chance to wrestle in more places than their school, and they should. Know what I mean? Like, I feel like Fair City, like I'm not being biased or anything, I feel like Fair City are a good example of that, because like, yeah, maybe not on every show, but some of their shows have like more than one women's matches. They've got women's matches headlining their shows and stuff as well. They're putting out like when you think about me and Serena Rose's match, like the build up for that match was great, and I feel like I've not seen that in Scottish women's wrestling outside ICW for a while. Mm-hmm. And things like that, I feel like they're paving a really good way for it, and I think that's what we need more than anything. Not more than anything, but selfishly, but you know what I mean.
Okay, yeah, you just want a bit more, because when I'm speaking to like Sov, pretty much all the names you mentioned, bar maybe a couple I haven't had on in chats in the past, but like Sov, Ellie Armstrong, and Nicole Jasmine, and Anastasia as well. It's like seeing women wrestle was the reason they became wrestlers, and I assume that would be in part for yourself as well. But even speaking to Nicole, she was on about her era was the diva era. And it was just women doing cool stuff, and it was Mickie James, and it was Melina, and all that kind of stuff. And it's like you forget that even through the worst of the diva stuff, where it was just all, I mean, when I started watching, it was because it was Archdera, and there was Lita, Trish, if you're lucky. Outside of that, Jacqueline would probably was a decent wrestler. That was Ivory. You know, it was very limited who he had. And then of course, diva era was. Is often lauded as being a bit, oh, it was just all about models looking good. But then when you dig deep into that time, you had your Beth Phoenix, you had your Mickie James, you had, for all of our criticisms, Michelle McCool became this incredible wrestler during that time. And you had Natalya, and you had all these great wrestlers. I'm sure they were overshadowed sometimes by the models that they're there to look good, but there was still good wrestling at times as well. So Victoria was round about then as well, and she is incredible. So there's reasons for whatever, whether it's they use a roster that's nearby and they're trying to put through some of their own school, or they are just lazy and they just don't want a woman on their show. It's just I don't know. It's I'm not booking shows. I don't know the answer.
I feel like there's a few places that it's very much just like, I'm going to book my pals. Mm-hmm. And like, I mean, I don't mind that these places don't book me. I'm absolutely okay with that. Like, I'm not out here to be like wrestling every day of my life. Like, I'm not built for that, man. Like, I just want wrestling to be better for people. I want it to be better for people that are younger and training, people coming up like Isla Sky, that's an island. Like, people coming up that are like Harmony Sky and the younger girls, they need somewhere better to be, not places that are just willing to book their mates because it's easier for them. It's that's not what it's about, man. Like, you've still got little girls in the crowd that need someone to look up to. They don't need to see like 10 guys wrestle. Like, it's still important for little girls to see big strong women and little strong women wrestle and show them that it can be done. It's just, maybe it's like, obviously we've got a bit heated, but like, it's just something I'm passionate about, and I think that we're not doing good enough personally.
The overarching answer to that is 5 years more inclusive. That's pretty much, but yeah, more inclusive match cards, rosters, just have a bit of everyone on.
Yeah, every more inclusive and safer environments.
Excellent. We'll try and reel it back a little bit because we don't want to end on a heated note. That just seems that just seems like a bad idea.
Passion. It's all it is. It's
exactly.
Passion.
Absolutely. So we've talked about like who you want to wrestle. You said there's places you want to get to. You mentioned Pro Wrestling Eve. Is there anyone else out there? I miss, you're seeing Aisha out in Japan. You're seeing Martina and Emerson Jane out in Israel at the moment as well. So where's your goals? Where do you want to get to? Which companies or countries are you wanting to wrestle in?
I'm a very firm believer in keeping my goals kind of shortish term. I'm not looking to go to like NXT or WWE or AEW or anywhere like that. It's just not really my desire. Like I said, like I'm 31, man. Like, I already feel like I'm on a bit of a clock here. So the three companies in Scotland that I really want to wrestle for are WrestleZone, Pro 2, and Disco. I follow a lot of what Pro 2 do, and I have a lot of friends that wrestle for them, and they honestly can't rave enough about them, and their shows look brilliant. And I genuinely believe that the shows that Cammy's arranging and the talent he's got on them are just, it's so good. And one thing I absolutely love is, again, reverting back, is you'll look at a Pro 2 poster and you'll see like so many guys, but then you'll also see like four or five women on it, which is just something you don't see. And I just think it's like, it's very, very refreshing. And I think they're putting out a very positive product. And I would love to be a part of that. I've always been a fan of Disco as well. I love going to Disco shows. And I feel like it's one of the only kind of companies left that I can go to as a fan and just be a fan and not think like a wrestler. I get so immersed in it. I love it so much. And it would be really, really cool to be a part of that, because it's Disco. Like, why wouldn't I want to be?
Yeah, absolutely. Wrestling last week I mentioned, of course, near and dear to my heart anyway. But they've kind of got that. They keep trying. And then some things happened. They had trainees that came through the school, one of which being Anastasia, They had matches with them on this card. And then, of course, they moved to Pastures New. I think one left the school. So I think I have heard in like Mickey's Mosh Pits and that with that, it's like they're like, we have women training, just they don't seem to stay, kind of thing. But so do the guys. The guys are the same. They come, they train, and they leave. And it's like, we're trying, kind of thing. Yeah. But
I mean, when you look at like when you look at like the demographic in schools, like if you look at Source alone, Source has so many amazing dudes in there. Mm-hmm. And then you've got myself and Cassie King and Athena. Like it's just the three of us. And I know that there's a few girls I've been speaking to who are looking to start coming and training at Source, which is really, really cool. But it does just highlight that I do understand there are a lot more male wrestlers than female wrestlers. I'm not ignorant to that at all, but
get one, get a couple on the card. Yeah.
Even just like, come on. Like just one match to start out with and then we'll build it up a bit.
A pre-show thing, test the waters kind of thing. Just like, baby steps. If
we double main event.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. That's all is future. But you know, you're speaking about that. Yeah, that's I mean, we mentioned things like Harmony Sky and Athena. I am obsessed with Athena. I don't know if anyone reads my Discovery reviews, but every time Athena's like in a match, I'm like, I want her in a match with Caleb Valhalla. I want it now. I want a match with Caleb and Athena. Just give me it.
Good.
Give me it. WrestleZone. Give me it. Discovery. Wrestle in the brain. I think I'd give it to me as well. The Caleb's up there. So yeah, give me. I want Athena, Caleb. Just I don't care how it goes. Just give me it. So yeah. I'm hoping Disco
she's
Derby.
Absolutely, she's fantastic, and she's a pure. She's built like a brick shit house, man. Like she's awesome, and she's so scary. She's just brilliant. She's fantastic.
That's it. It's like I was terrified when I got her on the show with Griffin. I was like, oh god, I don't know how this is gonna go. And then the thing came on, she was all smiling. And I was like, oh, that's just as terrifying, to be honest.
I know. I remember. Yeah.
I'm just as scared of you, to be honest. It doesn't matter what you do at this stage. But no, that's one I'm just keeping an eye out to see wrestle, because she's like unlike we're so lucky in Scotland to have so many different characters. Like I was saying, characters and colourful gimmicks and things going around. We've got Daisy Jenkins coming up as well, who has got this like throwback Sherry Martel gear going on, which looks amazing. And I'm like, there's so many, so many great characters in male and female in wrestling right now that you're just spoilt for choice. And, you know, we're lucky ones.
Spoilers. So do it. We're spoiled for choice. So spoilers.
Exactly. Right. I think that's a nice little high to end on because I'm sure I've asked you the sheep and cow question before.
Yeah, it's not changed.
Good, that's fine. Even though it's still two sheep, that's still the answer. I'm determined. Where
that is?
Yeah. Did as Leo sent you that video just out of curiosity? Leo McLean of the sheep versus the cow on YouTube.
No, but I don't care because it's two sheep. Two sheep are going to win.
Cool, that's fine.
Is he going for the whole cow tipping thing? Because do you see sheep tipping a cow?
Oh, no. I mean, I'll tell everyone now because they should have went to go see it. But no, it's a sheep and a cow run at each other and the sheep wins.
Is that a ram?
No.
Oh.
No, it's like a 14-second video. And it's a sheep running into a cow and the cow falls. So,
tell me this is not real.
Hang on, right. I'll find it. I'll put it. I'll see if I can link it in the. Is there a chat function here? I think there is. Sheep, the cow. There it is. Of course, it's been rewatched many times. It's already got there. Right, so, copy link address. Let's see. Right, chat. Hopefully, we can get a live reaction, or I can just. There you go. I think it's gone into the chat.
And then we need to learn how to use this. Right.
Oh, Brodie may disappear from the screen in a moment when she goes clicks that link.
More chat. Oh my god, I'm such a Luddite. It's bloody oh.
You're still all right. Your video's gone for a little second, but it's because you got that video up.
Wait for you to see. Oh lord, he's a coming. Right. I need to see that again. Right. Okay.
Out your back.
All right. So. So my take from that video is that cow is a dumbass. Because it so very obviously, like, got nothing I can use. I've got a giraffe over. No. Right. You got a cow, you've got a sheep. A cow is going to be taller than a sheep.
Right.
So if they're running in and they're going to get butt heads, the cow is going to have to come down to the sheep's level. So the cow comes down to the sheep's level and he goes down too low and he slides and falls onto his side. So cow's just a dumbass. Like,
I'm watching it again now. This
it
is
doesn't
amazing.
Prove anything, but I'm still firmly on the side of the sheep, but it doesn't prove anything.
No, it's enough for me. That's enough for me to confirm it. Anyway, right.
I still maintain they could take him upstairs and leave him there to die.
Oh, yeah. That's still my battle plan. That's the best way for it. And then you get, like, steaks at the end of it all. I prefer beef over lamb anyway.
No brainer.
Nah, absolutely.
Maybe not died of natural causes beef, but...
Maybe. Anyway, we'll leave that to ponder on our day. Right, where can people find out more about... I can't believe how much time we've had. I can't believe it. I'm looking at the time now going, how have we talked for this long?
Oh my goodness, it's nearly Fortnight time.
It's nearly my bedtime as well. Fortnite, how's your Fortnite going? I'm not really getting into the new season. I'm just not.
I've only played it once. I've just been so busy. No, I've only played it once, and it's weird. It's cool, but it's like, it's super psychedelic.
Mm.
And they've just got a lot of weird stuff going on. Like, I just want to go in and shoot people, for starters, and have a wee run about. I don't want to be planting trees and picking berries and shit, man. Just let me go in and shoot some noobs.
Yeah, I'm having a terrible time. I think I've got in top 10 once since the new season started. Oh. I'm just having a terrible terror time.
It's a nightmare to level up just now as well. It's taken so much to level up.
Ridiculous. It's like 80,000 XP to get into the next level. Fuck off. Just let me get Darth Vader. I don't want to pay for it. Right. We'll leave it on that. So where can people find out more about Brodie Adler? Should they need to know more over the last 5 hours that we've chatted over the 2 years? If they want to know more, where can they find you?
So you can find me on Twitter. And I'm pretty sure it's at brodie.adler. I can see you checking for me just now, which I appreciate.
Yep. It's Brodie _ Adler for those.
Oh, no, that means Instagram will be brodie.adler, isn't it?
I'll get your link tree up. You've got a link tree on Twitter for those that are unaware.
I really get that tattooed to me. Just like, yeah.
Brodie.adler on Instagram. And you can see the amazing face paint for Combat League is like the second photo on there as of recording.
Nice. I also have merch out now. So you can find me on Big Cartel, also under Brodie Adler. Or you can just go onto my Twitter and it's pinned right there. I got these awesome t-shirts designed by Robert Downey, who you may know does a lot of art for the wrestling community. So I've got some bitchin' t-shirts on sale on my Big Cartel. Also got some posters and some pictures. And if you're really nice, I might send you some stickers and a death threat. Oh, that was Albion. Albion bought a t-shirt and he got a death threat through the post. So, but yeah, I'll send nice stuff if you buy my t-shirts, because Brody needs some dollar.
Maybe even a poem, if they're so lucky.
Maybe. I'll see how my day is going. Maybe I'll just scrunch up a bit of paper with some spit and throw it in there if I'm having a bad day.
Oh, they can't do that. COVID. well, thank you very much for, again, having just a great chat. I'm not saying this is a great episode, but, you know, a bloody great episode. So people should be right to the end. So thank you again.
Thanks so much, dude.